Hi, I'm James Bednar from Anaconda, and I'm here to tell you how to make streaming data visualizations easy using hvPlot plus streamz. So are you interested in visualizing streaming or live data, but not planning to become a GUI programmer? You can try streamz together with hvPlot. And what you'll be able to do then is make streaming visualizations, but using APIs you already know. You don't have to learn how to become a GUI programmer. You don't have to learn about event loops and callbacks and widgets, none of that. So I'll try to show you how to make it easy and straightforward so you can easily switch between streaming and non-streaming visualizations. If you want to follow along, and this is a Jupyter notebook that you can download from the link that's on your screen. You'll also need Anaconda Project, which you can Conda install. So I'll tell you about each of the pieces involved here. First is streamz. It's a Python framework for working with streaming data, hence the name. And it's a powerful and fairly complex library, but I'll show you how to use it in a very simple way so you can just get started and immediately get to work on streaming viz. And one thing it provides is streaming pandas-based data frames. And so if you're familiar with pandas, it's just a pandas data frame, but the data in it keeps updating. And the streamz and streamz data frames work well with Jupyter, Tornado, Kafka, CUDA, Dask, Influx, lots of different sources of data and frameworks. So just to give you a really concrete example of what streamz looks like, here's a simple streamz data frame. And as you can see, if I look at the tail of it, the value of it, it will continually be updating to show the latest timestamp and several random values. This particular one is random, and it's an example we'll use throughout this talk, but then at the end of the talk, I'll show you how to use your own data sources, whatever they are, just by writing a couple lines of Python code to pull or query your data. So a streamz data frame like the one we just created is pandas, so you can use normal pandas operations on it. You can basically work with it. If you know the pandas API, you're already equipped to work with it. In this case, we're just calculating the sum, and of course the sum keeps changing over time when new random values come in. And we can look at other things, like if we look at the, we can actually calculate, take out a column of it, calculate fairly complicated column-based operations that you can do in Panda. And so basically, just think of it as pandas, but the numbers keep updating and you'll generally be about right. If you want the numbers to stop updating, you can certainly do that. It has an extra method called stop. So that way you can turn off the updates. And you'll notice that it was updating automatically here in this Jupyter notebook. And that's because it integrates with the Tornado event loop that runs this whole, it's the whole basis for Jupyter. And so that takes away a lot of the complexity involved here. Just use the event loop and the system that's already there for you. All right, so moving along to hvPlot. hvPlot also uses a pandas API. In fact, it uses the pandas.plot API. Here's the pandas.plot API, not using hvPlot, just the standard basic one. This one's based on matplotlib, and it'll give you, if you have a pandas data frame, you can call .plot and get a plot. So far, so good. But if you do that with hvPlot, we actually, by default, we don't call it .plot, we call it .hvPlot, just so that you can tell which one we're using in any example here. It's possible to install it as .plot as well. Anyway, this is now in a similar plot that you just like the one you just saw, but it's now interactive. You can hover, you can drag it around, you can zoom and such. We won't really use any of those features in this talk, but The fact that it's interactive means the data can be interactive too, and we will use that a lot. So what happens when you combine streams and hvPlot? Well, hopefully exactly what you would have expected. It's off the screen a bit here, but all you do is import hvPlot, but instead of hvPlot.pandas to install the pandas extension, you can do hvPlot.streams to install the streams backend. And then if you have another data frame here, this is again a streams random data frame. And this is also a streams, actually it's a streams random series in this case, but it works with either a series or a data frame. And if you do then call hvPlot on that, you get a plot where the data itself is automatically updating. Here I gave it a parameter called backlog, and that tells me to keep only the most recent 100 entries. And that's why you can see it sort of scrolling off to the left and disappearing. If I were to try to drag it back, it's not there anymore. There's no more data over there. So this, a plot like this can sit there running and not fill up memory. You don't have to use a backlog, but if you do, then that lets this be an ongoing safe thing to keep running because it won't be accumulating data forever. Anyway, that's the only thing that's specific to streams about this. Otherwise, it's just .hvPlot, which you could use on pandas, X-ray, Dask, lots of other objects. Here we're using it on a streams object. And so we get a streaming plot. But now at this point, you can, if you've got a streams data frame, you can just go to the hvPlot documentation and plot any, find any plot you like there, and then set up a suitable streams data source and plot it. I said that this was exactly what you'd expect. This actually has a little bit more functionality. hvPlot is like pandas.plot, but it adds additional things that are derived from a library called HoloViews. HoloViews supports star and plus operators, and those do overlays and layout, respectively. So here, what we're plotting is, on the right, we're plotting a box plot, and we're laying it out next to these two plots that are overlaid with each other. So we have the cumulative random value here in blue, and then we've overlaid on it a rolling mean of that same value in orange. And here you'll notice that we did not provide any option to control the backlog, and so the plot is just getting bigger and bigger over time, and the box plot here is just drifting with reporting the overall drift of the data here. All right, I'm sorry, I was interrupting that. And we can also go ahead and stop the data just so we can move on. You can certainly leave these running, but it gets confusing, particularly for reusing variables and so on. It's good practice if you're at least trying to tell a story to stop the things that you've started. Anyway, that should be enough to get you started with any of the existing streams data sources. And you can go from there to hvplot.holoviz.org and see all sorts of plots that you can do. This is just four of them. There are many, 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 many more. And all of those plots, once you learn them for a pandas data frame, they'll apply to streams and vice versa. So you really only need to know one API, and that's the pandas.plot API. You can learn a little bit more about the extra features of hvPlot if you want, and then apply them to standard pandas data frames or streams data frames. All right, so the question you're probably asking is, how can I stream my own data? You don't want to see random numbers. Streams is a very powerful library. It's got lots of complicated options. You can set up really interesting interfaces between anything. But what if you don't have any complicated needs and you just want to run a Python function and then plot the results? As I think I've mentioned, Tornado is behind the scenes in a Jupyter notebook, And when it showed a data frame updating, that was the reason it was updating in this Jupyter notebook was that the streams knows about Tornado, knows about the event loop that drives Tornado, and is able to register things on that loop, have them run periodically or in response to events, and so on. So that's a lot of complication behind the scenes. That's pretty much how anything works in Jupyter. Do you need to learn all those details? No, because I've given you a very simple example of what to do. And it's in this notebook here. We'll click on that in a minute, but first we'll just give you an idea what's in that notebook. And I've mentioned Jupyter, this the same code, everything in hvPlot, everything in this example will both work in Jupyter and in a standalone app if it's based on Bokeh or Panel, both of which use Jupyter, use Tornado as well. So streams is not limited to Tornado. The stuff that I'm showing is specific to Tornado, but Tornado's very widely available. It's available as part of Jupyter. It's also available as part of Bokeh and Panel. And so that's the specific use case I'm focusing on. So if you are using Tornado, you can use a little helper function that I've I'll show you in a second. But all you need to do is write a little function like this, fetch data, and it returns a pandas data frame of any length. In this case, it's returned a data frame of with one row in it, but you can return lots of rows if you want to batch it up. And you can, and this particular one is stateless. It just calls and returns whatever the current value is. You can make it very slightly more complicated if you want to make sure to batch things up and not, and respect the last data that you sent. There are other things you can do without having to abandon this approach. But in the simplest case, if you can call a Python library that might read a value from the web or pull a web server somewhere or read a register on your machine, whatever, anything you can do to get a value, all you need is a function like this. And then you can plug it into a little class I wrote called Tornado Data Frame. And here I've passed in the name of that function. And all this function, all this is going to do is set up a interface to the Tornado I/O loop and say that every 300 milliseconds, run this function. And that's it. That's all you have to do. Tornado will automatically call this function every 300 milliseconds. You'll end up with a data frame here that you can show or that you can plot, and you can use hvPlot on that point. At that point. So I'll come to a conclusion, but then right after the conclusion, I'll actually show you what's in Tornado data stream as an example. So the conclusion of this part, which is the talk itself, not the demo. It's easy to make a custom streaming data frame with streams. And once you do, it's easy to plot them using hvPlot. And once you have a plot, you can actually deploy it as an app. And I'll just mention that in a minute. And all of this is encapsulated in this one little notebook here. If you want to go further than what I show in this talk, you can see a lot about streaming at HoloViews. That uses much more difficult concepts than what I've covered here. If you don't need that power, don't bother. But if you want to control every little bit, go for it. Check out HoloViews. Panel also offers support for streams. And in Panel, you can use streams together with any plotting library. Here, I've only shown hvPlot. There's also a library now called CU Streams that allows you to use CUDA GPU. I won't cover any of that material, but you can check that out yourself. Meanwhile, I will open this library, this notebook here, and I won't go into the details, but I'll just show you what's in here, which is, this is a little class I wrote. You don't need to read the code in particular because you don't actually need to edit any of it. It's a copy of the random class that I already illustrated. It's just a copy of that where you can overload the data fun with whatever data query function you want instead of only being supporting random. And I'll try to get this into streams. I've not talked to the streams maintainers. I think something like this would make sense to put directly in the streams library. But meanwhile, all you have to do is copy it from this notebook that that comes with the talk. And as long as you've got that, then you write a function. In this case, I wrote two functions. Actually, I'll run this code. And then as long as you've defined the functions, this is all that you as a user are expected to do, is write those two functions. And then you can make a couple of data frames. In this case, what these functions do, these use a library called psutil to query the CPU utilization and the memory utilization on my laptop. And you can run that on your own laptop. In this particular one, it's showing you that I have 12 CPUs, and it shows that they're running right now. I do have some things running. They alternate here. These are virtual hyper-threaded CPUs, so only the odd numbered ones are the even numbered ones are the real ones. The odd ones are just extras. Anyway, those details don't too much matter. All that matters is that there's a function here. It's being called every 300 milliseconds, and it finds out the CPU and memory utilization, and it comes back as a streams data frame. So of course, if it's a streams data frame, all you have to do to plot it is use hvPlot. So here we have an instant CPU and memory monitoring app. We just imported hvPlot. We created a plot of the memory usage. That's the one on the bottom here. It has both used and free information, because if I look back at my memory data, it has a column for used and a column for free. And so it's going to plot those. You can see it's fluctuating a little bit. I haven't launched any new apps or anything while I've been doing this, so it's not varying very much. And then the CPU usage is also varying. And you can see it's the same values that were in the data frame, again, alternating between the CPU. And all this did is we have a plot here of a line plot of the memory usage, a box plot of the CPU usage, and then we set some options on the CPU usage to color them, make them look nicer, and label the, we've added some labels and such. And we're only holding the last 200 entries. And last bit here, if you go ahead and save this notebook, and then on a command line you run this command, it'll launch a separate server that just has this plot. So let's go ahead and clear and restart this notebook. We're starting to clear output. And then go ahead and I'll just do it from within the notebook itself. So I'll just act like we've just executed it, just so I don't have to switch outside of Jupyter. And then we'll execute this cell, which is going to launch a separate server. And as you can see, that opens now as a separate server. And so this is now, it would be the same if I launched it from the command line, but harder to get to from Jupyter. So now you can see we made a streaming standalone web server with dynamically updating plots, streaming data frame, all in Python, all in a very few lines of Python. And now we can share this with people, or just run it and use it and enjoy our little app on this computer. Now you should be able to follow this example and do exactly the same things and with any of your own data. So let's exit and put that link up there again. The link to download it is, I had it at the very beginning. So the link to download it is this link. Just download that, unpack that, run Anaconda project, and you can all reproduce all this yourself. Thank you.